Yes. After the digression into last lecture, we'll move on to the subject of today's lecture, which is on the maximum mass of neutron stars. So let us recall what we discussed about neutron stars in one of the earlier lectures. Very quickly to recall, we said the story began in 1938 with Landau advancing the idea of star made up more or less entirely of neutrons. And that idea originated from Hund in 1936, who said that under certain circumstances, all the protons and electrons can combine to form neutrons. But the difficulty in such a scenario was that the reaction proton plus electron going to neutrons and neutrino is strongly endothermic. How strongly endothermic? You need 10 to the power 18 ergs, 7 times 10 to the power 18 ergs to convert just 1 gram of ordinary matter into 1 gram of neutrons. So clearly that will not happen spontaneously. So Landau's idea, brilliant idea, was that under certain circumstances, that energy that you need to convert protons to neutrons can be provided by the gravitational binding energy of a huge mass which is contracting to smaller and smaller radius. So gm squared over r will supply the energy that you need. And pictorially, what we said was electronic matter, as Landau called it in the left, a star made up of protons and electron, for some reason collapses. And the reason, of course, was provided by Chandrasekhar. It is possible that the mass is greater than 1.4 solar mass, and therefore electron pressure cannot support it against gravity. So it collapses. And in the process of collapse, protons combine with electrons to form neutrons. And what you finally get is a small sphere made up of neutrons. And it will come to an equilibrium state when the density reaches roughly 10 to the power 14 grams per cubic centimeter, which is the density of terrestrial atomic nuclei. Very good. Now we will go from 1938 in Moscow to 1938 in Berkeley, California. And there we met Robert Oppenheimer, who was a very unusual physicist. First of all, he was a sheer genius. Secondly, he came from a New York, very rich New York Jewish family. And so culturally, he was a very sophisticated person, extremely well-versed in literature, art, music. He knew Sanskrit. He had read this literature in Sanskrit and things like that. He could speak various European languages, extremely knowledgeable about classical music. And he was also, incidentally, a terribly clever physicist who went to Europe and worked with Max Born for his PhD thesis. This paper by Landau attracted the attention of Oppenheimer. And he asked the following question. We know that there is a maximum mass for white dwarfs, where gravity is supported by the degeneracy pressure of the electrons, and Chandrasekhar had taught us that that mass is 1.4 solar mass. Is there a similar maximum mass for neutron stars? If so, what is it? And then, of course, when a professor has an interesting problem, what does he do? He tries to find a clever student who will work on it. And the student, and Oppenheimer was surrounded with knee-deep of extremely brilliant young students, because everybody clustered to Oppenheimer. At that time, please remember, there were not many centers of excellence in science in America. Science was more or less a European phenomena. But there were some centers, Gibbs in Yale University, and there were a few people, and Oppenheimer was the star in the West Coast. He was a professor both at Caltech and also in Berkeley. So he chose Volkov, young Volkov, to do this problem. He said, look, I want you to do exactly what Chandrasekhar did, but two differences. Just go and do it. The first difference is, instead of electrons supplying the degeneracy pressure, this time gravity is supported by degeneracy pressure of the neutrons. But go and use the same formula by Chandrasekhar. Instead of mass of electron, you put the mass of neutron. That's all. It's very simple as that. But he said, but you see, there's one more difference. He said, Chandrasekhar used Newtonian gravity. The equation of hydrostatic equilibrium was dp by dr is minus gm rho over r squared. So the right-hand side is neutral. He said, when you're dealing with a neutron star, which is 10 kilometers in size, general relativistic corrections could be important. Therefore, you must study gravity. The right-hand side of gm rho over r squared should be replaced by the general relativistic expression corresponding to gm rho over r squared. And he also told him what that equation ought to be. But first, what do we expect? We know that a fully relativistic white dwarf has no radius. He has no radius, but it has a unique mass. It has no radius because, as we saw in our discussion of the Chandrasekhar limit, as you go to more and more massive stars, the radius gets smaller and smaller and smaller, and finally it nosedives to zero radius at that mass. So the Chandrasekhar mass should be interpreted as a limiting mass of white dwarfs. And that mass, of course, is given by this beautiful expression multiplied by 1 over mu e squared, where mu e is the mean molecular weight. In other words, mu e mp is the mass per electron. So if you have a helium nucleus, there are 2 electrons, but 4 nucleons. Therefore, mass per electron is 2. So mu e was 2. And that is why this became 1.4. But if I have only neutrons, then mu is 1. You have only neutrons, so mu is 1. So the limiting mass of neutron star will be just 4 times this. Simple as that. Right? You understand why mu is 1? I mean, each particle, I mean, this time, pressure is supplied by neutrons, gravity is also felt by neutrons. Fine. So what you would find, what you would expect, is that if you were to blindly use Newtonian theory and try to estimate what is the maximum mass of neutron stars following exactly what Chandrasekhar did, you will find that that radius goes to 0 at a mass of 5.76 solar mass, which is 4 times 1.44 solar mass. So let's call that the Chandrasekhar limiting mass for neutron stars. But is that the limiting mass for neutron stars? No. That is the limiting mass of neutron stars if you use Newtonian gravity. But Oppenheimer told Volkov, don't do that. Use the general relativistic equation of hydrostatic equilibrium, which is shown over there. The terms in yellow are the ones we wrote before. dp by dr is minus gm rho over r squared. That is Mr. Newton. In what way does Einstein's gravity differ from Newtonian gravity? We discussed that yesterday. It differs because in Newtonian theory, mass is just the inertial mass. Whereas in general relativity, all forms of energy, because of special relativity, have an equivalent mass. Therefore, there are what you wrote as small mr is the rest mass of the star. The rest mass of each elementary particle multiplied by the total number of elementary particles. That's what Newton would have done. But we know that these particles have various energy. They have potential energy. There is pressure. Pressure is also, so pressure is just energy per unit volume. So pressure is also a source of gravity and general relativity. Therefore, I leave it to you as a very simple exercise. It should not take more than 5 minutes to convince yourself that this, for example, very simple, density. Density, pressure is energy divided by unit volume. So that is energy density. Energy density is rho c squared. So if I divide by c squared, I get what is the contribution to density term arising from general relativity. So similarly, convince yourself that the first term also gets modified and you get that term over there. And the denominator, of course, represents the curvature of space with Schwarzschild properly calculated. Instead of r squared in the denominator, which is Newton's theory, you have r squared into 1 minus 2gm by rc squared. Okay, we'll return to this when we discuss black holes. You notice that if I set c equal to infinity, all the green terms go to zero. And what I'm left with is good old Newtonian equation of hydrostatic equilibrium, dp by dr is minus gm rho over r squared. So I submit to you that the equation shown at the top of the slide, which is known as Tolman-Oppenheimer-Polkov equation, is the correct equation of hydrostatic equilibrium to use in general relativity, provided you are dealing with spherical masses or non-rotating masses and so on. So what Oppenheimer told young Volkov is, look, take this equation for the pressure. Instead of the pressure of the electrons that Chandrasekhar used, use the degeneracy pressure of the Fermi gas of neutrons using the same formula. The pressure is density to the power 5 by 3. And the mass, the denominator, you put the mass of the neutron. But he also told him, but don't make any approximations. Do an exact calculation. And Volkov did that. Remember, these are not very easy to do in days when you didn't have computers and you didn't have electric calculators. But he did that within a year. And this is what he found. Oppenheimer-Volkov result is shown here. What is shown in this plot in the y-axis is the mass of various objects. And what is shown on the x-axis is the central density. Earlier, while discussing Chandrasekhar's theory of white dwarf, we plotted radius versus mass. This time, I'm plotting mass in the y-axis and central density instead of radius along the x-axis. That green curve is the sequence of white dwarfs, stable white dwarfs, that Chandrasekhar had calculated. You notice that the white dwarf curve terminates at a mass of 1.4 solar mass, a density around 10 to the power 10 grams per cubic centimeter, which is where neutronization begins and the electrons begin to disappear. What Volkov calculated is this dashed red line. Interestingly, this curve has a maximum and then it goes down and there is indeed a minimum. But you know that as you go to larger and larger masses, the central density must increase. Common sense. But as you go to, by the same token, as you go to smaller and smaller masses, the central density must decrease. But you notice, to the right of this maximum, as the mass decreases, the central density increases. Therefore, that is not allowed. So you have to do a proper justification for why this is not allowed, but this is a simple argument for why it is not allowed. Therefore, the only allowed stable branch of neutron stars is what is shown in the green, whereas the mass increases, central density increases. So you clearly see that this maximum should be identified as the maximum possible mass of the neutron star. You notice that the maximum mass of a neutron star is around 0.7 solar mass, less than the Chandrasekhar limiting mass for white dwarfs. So what are the basic results? The maximum mass of the neutron star is 0.7 solar mass. The radius of the neutron star of this mass is about 10 kilometers. Now you may say, but the maximum mass, the radius should be zero. No, I never said the radius should be zero. The radius becomes zero when the star becomes fully relativistic. Long before that, something else happens and the star becomes unstable. So there is a maximum mass. The point to appreciate is that the central density of a neutron star of the maximum mass will be roughly 50 times the nuclear density, or 5 times 10 to the power 15 grams per cubic centimeter. So let's go back to our plot of the radius on the y-axis and mass on the x-axis. The yellow line is the non-relativistic configuration, where the radius is inversely proportional to the cube root of the mass. And the dashed red line is the fully relativistic theory, and the star goes to zero radius when it reaches a mass of roughly 5.76 solar mass. But the real maximum mass of the neutron star is not where it would be as in Newtonian gravity, but in general relativity, the maximum mass of the neutron star is about 0.7 times the mass of the sun. Okay, this is just in a pictorial, I'm telling you, repeating what Oppenheimer and Volkov had calculated. Please notice that the Oppenheimer-Volkov mass, maximum mass, is much smaller than the Chandrasekhar limiting mass for a neutron star. And that is because, as I said already, its radius is not zero, but it's about 10 kilometers. The reason is, when the neutron star reaches its maximum mass, it is not fully relativistic. It's mildly relativistic. But it still becomes unstable. Okay, unstable to collapse. And of course, after that, nothing can save it. It becomes a black hole, as we will see. So don't confuse the maximum mass of a neutron star with its radius going to zero. Okay? So maximum mass in the sense that if you go to a larger mass, then it is unstable. Although the maximum mass of the neutron star came to 0.7 solar mass, Oppenheimer conjectured already in 1938 that the real maximum mass of a neutron star may be significantly larger, maybe one or two solar mass. And the reason he said that was, he said that, look, when you go to more and more massive neutron stars, the central density will get larger and larger and larger. Therefore, neutron attractive force will become a repulsive force. And therefore, this time there are two agents helping you against gravity. First, there is the degeneracy pressure of the neutrons. And also, since neutrons are pushing against each other, that repulsion will also help you to support against gravity. Therefore, you will be able to support a larger mass if you included that repulsion. But they didn't know how to include the repulsion. The reason is, okay, before that, there is something that I want to discuss, which is very important. Please remember that although in deriving this maximum mass, Oppenheimer and Volkov had used the general relativistic expression for the equation of hydrostatic equilibrium, they continued to use the Chandrasekhar expression for pressure of the neutrons. And that is for an ideal neutron gas. Chandrasekhar had used it for an ideal electron gas. So let's return to this question and ask an interesting question. What do you mean by an ideal Fermi gas? What do you mean by an ideal gas? What do you mean by an ideal gas? Boyle's law is obeyed by ideal gas. Is that although molecules of air may interact with one another, the distance between the molecules is so large, the mean distance, that the kinetic energy is much larger than the intermolecular potential energy. Therefore, the ratio of kinetic energy to potential energy is very, very large. Therefore, you can ignore the interaction. You cannot ignore the interaction when you come to this density. That is why Van der Waals introduced corrections to Boyle's law. arising out of molecular interaction. Now, if you have to abandon Boyle's law at a density of 1 gram per cubic centimeter, what business did Chandrasekhar have to assume an ideal gas approximation for a gas which was at 1 million grams per cubic centimeter? Surely that must be nonsense. So you can't believe anything Chandrasekhar did in his theory of white dwarfs. No, he didn't do anything wrong. But we must understand why, regardless of a density of 1 million grams per cubic centimeter, a gas of electrons remains ideal. In fact, it is even more ideal than at a density of 1 gram per cubic centimeter. Why is that so? Let's try to understand. Please remember that in a real metal, forget 1 million grams per cubic centimeter, at a density of 5 or 6, copper, sodium, gold, interaction between electrons is very important. And it is this interaction that leads to phenomena like magnetism, superconductivity, superfluidity, and things like that. So ignoring interactions at 1 gram per cubic centimeter, you can't do. So how can you do it at 1 million grams per cubic centimeter? Okay, so that is explained in the figure over here. What I have shown here as black dots or 2 electrons, say in a metal. And let us say the mean density of electron is small n. That is, number of electrons per unit volume is small n. What do we mean by that? We mean the following. If the mean distance between the electron is roughly R0, in other words, if I draw a sphere around an electron of radius R0 and another sphere of radius R0 around the next electron, there is only one electron inside that sphere, there is only one electron inside that sphere, and so on, right? Fine. Therefore, we have this simple relation that 4 pi by 3 R0 cubed into n is 1. That's what we mean, that's how we define the mean particle distance and the density. Therefore, please notice that I can invert this equation and say the mean distance between the electrons is proportional to density to the power minus 1 by 3. Okay? No fiddle, I've not cheated. Now, how does the kinetic energy depend? Kinetic energy of the electron can have all kinds of values. Typical value is the Fermi energy. Maybe 2/3 the Fermi energy, 3/5 the Fermi energy, 1/2 the Fermi energy, but it's of the order of the Fermi energy. And the Fermi energy is proportional to density to the power 2 by 3. How does the potential energy of interaction between 2 electrons? It goes as E squared over R0, which is density to the power 1 by 3 from that blue box. Therefore, you see that the ratio of the kinetic energy to potential energy increases as density to the power 1 by 3. Therefore, as I increase n, kinetic energy increases, potential energy also increases, but kinetic energy increases much faster. Therefore, an electron gas has a peculiar property that is, as its density increases, it becomes more and more ideal. That sentence is from Landau and Lifshitz statistical physics. That's an example of the kind of gold mine that book is. Okay? So if you read the book very carefully, there will be this sentence: an electron gas has a peculiar property that is just the way Coulomb energy transforms with density and the kinetic energy of a Fermi gas transforms with density. Right? Okay. But this is not true of neutron gas, because 2 neutrons interact not by Coulomb potential, but they interact by nuclear potential, and this is some 1 over r to the power 12 or something like that. It's not 1 over r. Therefore, as you make the distance between the particles smaller and smaller, the potential energy grows much faster than the kinetic energy. Therefore, you cannot use the ideal gas law for neutrons. Whereas Oppenheimer told Volkov, you use the ideal neutron gas thing, because he said, we don't know the shape of this potential very well in 1938. That is why he conjectured that someday when you know this potential better from collision experiments, you will conclude that this nucleon-nucleon repulsion will also help to support gravity, and the maximum mass will not be 0.7, but maybe 2 or 3 solar mass. They were not in a position to say that, but Oppenheimer already said, watch out. So to repeat, this is our modern picture of how an internuclear potential energy curve looks like. Oppenheimer and Volkov supported the star against gravity only with the degeneracy pressure of the neutrons. Now, as you know, the repulsion is going to contribute, but they were not in a position to calculate it, but merely conjecture that nuclear repulsion will increase the maximum mass to a few solar masses. Then we have to see, almost 100 years later, what physicists have to say about this. We'll come to that. Now, I want to ask a very important question. We talked about mass on the y-axis, central density on the x-axis. We said there is a branch of white dwarfs, cold stars, and then there is a branch of neutron stars. These are cold stars, meaning their temperatures are very small compared to characteristic energy of that system. Why are there only two kinds of cold stars? There are stars supported by electrons, then there are stars supported by neutrons. There are so many elementary particles we know of, they keep discovering more and more of them. So why don't we have all kinds of stars? So we asked this very interesting and extremely important question. Why are there only two classes of cold stars? The white dwarfs and the neutron stars. Okay, this is a rather important question, and let's try to understand this. This question takes us to a more fundamental question, namely, what is the condition for the stability of matter? What is the ultimate condition for the stability of matter? Its compressibility must be positive. In other words, if I try to compress this object, it must cost me energy. But by compressing, suppose I gain in energy, then you'll go on, it will spontaneously compress, and it will collapse. So the stability of matter requires that the compressibility should be positive. Fine. And what does that translate to? It translates to the following criterion. For a star to be stable, gamma, remember good old gamma, the ratio of specific heat at constant pressure to specific heat at constant volume, Cp by Cv, should be greater than 4 by 3. What is gamma for an ideal gas? For ideal gas, for Boyle's law, nobody knows? I asked, what is the gamma of an ideal gas? I'm not talking about degrees of freedom. I am a bit disappointed. Okay. You should be able to calculate this from your BSc thermodynamics. Calculate the free energy, take the derivative, property derivative at constant volume, constant pressure, take the ratio. Now the statement is, this gamma should be greater than 4 by 3. Where does this condition come from? The following, let us say that there is a star of a certain mass and a certain radius. I compress that star to a smaller radius, R prime, and the mass is still m. If I compress the star adiabatically, that means I don't allow energy to flow in or flow out of the system, then I know from adiabatic relation, PV to the power gamma is a constant. Does that ring a bell? Remember, PV to the power gamma is a constant? Boyle's law is PV is RT. For an adiabatic process, PV to the power gamma is a constant. Therefore, as I compress the star, the pressure will increase. Fine. But the pressure will also increase for another reason inside the star, namely, pressure at any point inside is the weight of the unit cylinder sitting on my head. And because the density is increasing, the gravity, which is gm over r squared, is increasing. The question is, which pressure is going to be greater? In other words, if I compress the star, will it bounce back? Or would it like to become even smaller? So if you look at that properly, write down, compare the way at which, let us say you go from a radius R1 to R2, you know how much the pressure increases just by adiabatic compression. Similarly, calculate the gravitational pressure at some imaginary distance in the original star and the compressed star, and convince yourself that the stability criterion in Newton's theory of gravity requires that gamma should be greater than 4/3, and I do not want to take the time to prove that to you here. I think it's a simple exercise, and you should be able to do it. The first thing is to draw two pictures like I've drawn on the board, and write down how the adiabatic pressure increases in an adiabatic compression, and how the gravitational pressure increases. And the upshot of it all is the following. If gamma is less than 4/3, the compressibility will be negative. It will be negative in the sense that the star would like to compress even more and even more and even more. In other words, it will spontaneously collapse. Fine. Now, since the pressure varies as a function of density inside the star, you may say, look, I can't characterize the star by a single gamma. Because at different points, different radii, the density is different, the pressure is different. Okay, gamma varies a little bit. Let's take an average gamma. Let's take an average. How do you take an average? Arithmetic average, geometric average? No, you calculate the average over pressure. In other words, the pressure varies as a function of R, gamma into P of R dr divided by integral dr will give you the pressure average gamma. So you say, if you really want to be sophisticated, you say the pressure average gamma should be greater than 4/3. Now, how do you calculate gamma as a function of density? Well, you have to know the equation of state. So you start with extremely low density. We know Boyle's law. Then if you go to higher density, Boyle's law has to be abandoned. Thank you. And you have to go to Fermi-Dirac pressure. Then later on, all kinds of other crazy things happen. Then nuclei come into the picture. Nuclear repulsion comes into the picture. Nuclear attraction. So as you go to higher and higher density, you have to include more and more aspects of physics and do an honest calculation of the pressure as a function of density. And then calculate gamma. People have done that. It took them 30, 40 years to do that. And that's shown in the figure. What is shown on the y-axis is the calculated value of the adiabatic index gamma on the y-axis, and on the x-axis is the logarithm of the density of matter. 10 to the power 6 is the white dwarf density. 10 to the power 10, thereabouts, is roughly the density of a white dwarf of the Chandrasekhar mass. So you see, there is a dashed line, which is gamma is equal to 4/3. And the meaning of the dashed line is that only the segment shown in green is a stable branch of matter, and what is shown in the dashed line is unstable. So the region above 4/3 is stable, shown in green. The region below the dashed line is unstable, which is shown in red. So as I increase the density of matter, you come to a density where matter becomes compressible. Compressibility becomes negative. You know what happens here? This is where neutronization sets in. Electrons begin to disappear, neutrons begin to appear. So why the hell don't neutrons apply pressure? Because there is a factor of 2000 in the denominator in the pressure. So you have to go to a much higher density before neutrons say stop. And that's why it starts rising again. And when it comes to gamma, these are the neutron stars. Okay? So that's the reason why there are two branches of stars. But let's look at this a little more carefully. So far, we only discussed protons and electrons on the left at very low density, and then only neutrons at very high density. But you really, there is a lot more to the story. And as we discuss, when we discuss the interior of neutron stars, various people have calculated equations of state, starting with Harrison and Wheeler in Princeton in 1958. And what is shown here in yellow is the Harrison-Wheeler equation of state and the derived value of gamma corresponding to that in the previous picture in yellow there. That is HW stands for Harrison-Wheeler, OV stands for Oppenheimer and Volkoff. So if I now marry Oppenheimer-Volkoff equation of state with the Harrison-Wheeler equation of state, what I find is that I have a branch of stable white dwarf with a maximum mass, which is the Chandrasekhar limiting mass. Then we have a region of unstable configurations, and then you have the stable neutron stars, and then an unstable branch of neutron stars. Now at this point, if you go to the Oppenheimer-Volkoff neutron star, previously when I had shown the green line, I had plotted the green line from here all the way up to the maximum. In other words, in Oppenheimer-Volkoff theory, there was no minimum mass for a neutron star. Just as in Chandrasekhar's theory of white dwarf, there was no minimum mass for the white dwarf. Radius as a function of mass is 1 over m to the power 1 by 3. You could have as a smaller mass and as large a radius. There is no minimum mass for a white dwarf. In the same way, in Oppenheimer-Volkoff theory, there was no minimum mass for a neutron star. There is only a maximum mass for a neutron star. But of course, if you do the thing properly, you notice that there is a minimum mass also. How do you calculate the minimum mass? You ask at what mass and what central density gamma becomes equal to 4 by 3. So that's the minimum mass. So the minimum mass of the neutron star, according to the Harrison-Wheeler equation of state, if you use some other equation of state, you'll get a number slightly different. These are all minor sophistications add on. You find the minimum mass of a neutron star is 0.1 solar mass. And its radius will be quite large, not 10 kilometers, but 160 kilometers. But its central density is still more or less the same. The question is, why is there a minimum mass? It's all for equation to say that gamma becomes 4/3 there, therefore there should be a minimum mass. But why is there a minimum mass? Let's try to understand that rather simply. This relates to a question that was asked in one of the earlier lectures. The person who asked, I don't think, is here in the audience today. The question was, why doesn't a neutron star become unstable to radioactive decay? Why don't the neutrons decay? And the answer we said was, lay in the principle of chemical potential. We said the chemical potential of the neutron, which is the Fermi energy, must be equal to the chemical potential of the proton plus the Fermi energy of the electrons. So we said the electrons are populated up to an energy EF, which is proportional to density to the power 2 by 3. Fine. Now let us say a neutron says, no, I'm unhappy, I would like to go back to being a proton and an electron. So I create an electron and a proton. Now this electron, if I have a neutron on the tabletop and it decays to a proton and electron, the energy of the electron will be difference in the rest mass energy of the neutron and the proton. So it will more or less be on the table, or maybe it has enough energy, it will fall out of the table. But here we are not talking of a neutron on the tabletop. We are talking of a neutron inside a neutron star at a density of 10 to the power 14 grams per cubic centimeter. And about 5% are electrons. Therefore, the Fermi energy is very large. It is several million electron volt. Therefore, this electron can only vacant apartment in this building is on top of the Fermi energy. So this electron has to go and sit there. If it cannot climb and sit there, it will not be produced. That is why decay of neutrons in a neutron star is inhibited. It's inhibited by beta equilibrium. That is the statement of beta equilibrium. Now let us go to smaller and smaller mass white dwarfs or neutron stars. The density becomes smaller and smaller and smaller because the central density is proportional to the square of the mass. So the Fermi energy becomes smaller and smaller and smaller. At some density, the electron will be able to go and sit there. So at that point, neutrons will become unstable. So if you go to a mass smaller than the minimum mass, the neutron star will suddenly poof, it will puff up 1,000 times in radius, and once again it will become a proton electron star, in other words, it will become a white dwarf, crudely speaking. So that is why there is a minimum mass. There is a minimum mass because you can no longer guarantee that neutrons will not be unstable against beta decay. All right, so that's the summary there. This is the reason why there are only two classes of neutron stars. Let's see where we are. Now let's go back to the question of the maximum mass. Now let us say that I want to know what is the maximum possible mass. In other words, yes, people are doing their best. Oppenheimer and Volkov did their best. You can try to improve it. If you knew your nuclear physics better, you can include nuclear repulsion. You can get a better estimate. But can I say something? You do what you like, but I can tell you a neutron star can never be more massive than this. Can you make a statement as positive as Chandrasekhar did for white dwarf? The answer is yes, you can. What is the stiffest equation of state? Stiffest meaning something that is stiff against compression. That will give you the maximum mass. What are the constraints on the equation of state? There are two constraints. First is microscopic stability. Microscopic stability requires that dp by d rho should be greater than zero. If dp by d rho is less than zero, it means compressibility of matter is negative. Then matter will be unstable. Isn't it? I don't care what your physics is. But you better guarantee that dp by d rho is always positive, right? But there's one more thing. As I go to higher and higher density, because I'm greedy, I want to make larger and larger mass neutron stars. If I increase the density, the speed of sound will increase. You remember, the speed of sound depends on the density. That's why if there is a seismic explosion somewhere, you first detect it through the earth and then through the atmosphere because sound travels faster in the solid. But you can't be greedy. Beyond a certain pressure, the speed of sound will exceed the speed of light if you went on increasing the density. Therefore, there is a limit on dp by d rho. And that is the causality condition. Namely, at no time can the square of the speed of sound be greater than the square of the speed of light. So I can ask, suppose I construct a star at that limiting stiffness that these two criteria permit, then what will be the mass of that object? Yeah. So in a sense, I'm asking the following question. Theoretically speaking, what is the maximum mass a neutron star can have? So how do you approach this problem? Well, don't throw up your hand like that and say that. Because suppose this is the neutron star shown in the slide. At densities which are shown in the green portion of the neutron star, I understand my physics fairly well. So I can write what the pressure, how the pressure should depend upon the density. It's only when I come to a maximum possible density rho m, which is the magenta portion of the neutron star, I throw up my hands and say, look, there I don't know the details. So I don't have to say I will use the stiffest possible equation of state everywhere in the star. I'll say, no, I'll be as honest as possible in the green region. And then when I come to the magenta region, I will throw up my hands and say I will use the stiffest possible equation of state. In other words, use a reliable equation of state for rho less than rho m. What is rho m? You decide. That depends on your degree of confidence in the physics that you know. Okay, you may use one value of rho m, he may use some other value of rho m. But the choice is yours. But inside that region, you should use the equation of state. The pressure is rho c squared, which is the stiffest possible equation of state, where the speed of sound is equal to the speed of light. So if I use that, what is the maximum mass you get? 4.8 solar mass. This was first calculated by Jim Hartle and his collaborators in the 1970s. So it is 4.8 solar mass times a factor which is square root of 2 times 10 to the 14 grams per cubic centimeter divided by the density at that boundary that you decide. So if you want to stop at 2 times 10 to the power 14, that bracket is 1. If you go to a higher density, that factor will give a correction. But roughly speaking, the theoretical limit for the maximum mass of a neutron star based on the condition of microscopic stability and causality is around 4.8 solar mass. This is not to say that a real neutron star can be that massive. It says you won't violate any physics. But something else may intervene and that may become a black hole due to some other dynamical instability criterion. Okay. Now, what about the fact that neutron stars rotate? If neutron stars rotate, we talked of pulsars. We'll be now talking of pulsars which spin even faster. So centrifugal force becomes larger and larger. That will certainly support against gravity. We ignored that for white dwarf because the rotation is not that important. You can't ignore that for neutron stars. And John Friedman, who was one of my classmates, he was Chandrasekhar's student, PhD, terribly clever physicist, who did many outstanding things. His PhD thesis, Chandrasekhar, was a masterpiece. He calculated this many years ago, and he found the maximum mass to be about 6 solar mass. In other words, the maximum mass of a rotating neutron star is roughly 20% more than the maximum mass of a non-rotating neutron star. White dwarf also rotation will contribute, but there it can be almost the stability, rotating white dwarf maximum mass can be almost 50% more than the Chandrasekhar mass. But we are not discussing white dwarf now, we are discussing neutron stars. So the two numbers to remember are 4.8 solar mass and 6 solar mass. All right, now let us turn to the very center of the neutron star, which we left as an open question when we discussed the interior of neutron star. We discussed neutron superfluidity, proton superconductivity, and the question was, what about the central region of the neutron star? And I left it open. So let us return to that question now. So far, we have talked only of electrons, protons, and neutrons, and protons becoming neutrons at a higher density. But we know there are other elementary particles. Well, there are light particles like mu mesons. Let's not worry about mu meson because we're talking of gravity, so we talk of a little heavier particle. But then there are the pi mesons. It comes in three varieties, pi plus, pi zero, and pi minus. And the mass of the pi meson is roughly 140 million electron volts. So it's much heavier than the electron. The important thing is, pi mesons obey Bose-Einstein statistics and not Fermi-Dirac statistics. Okay. What has that got to do with the price of fish? Everything. So we'll come to that now. Let us remember why a neutron star was stable. We discussed this just a minute ago in the board. That's because of beta equilibrium, which requires that the Fermi energy of the neutron should be equal to the Fermi energy of the protons plus the Fermi energy of the electron. Strictly speaking, I should say chemical potential, but at very low temperature, they are the same. Now, the point I want to make is, as the density increases, neutrons will suddenly become unstable to creating pi mesons. What did the neutrons do previously? If they had a possibility, they decayed to protons and electrons. But now, a neutron can say, when the difference between the chemical potential of the neutrons and protons becomes larger than the rest mass energy of the pi meson, I should really put C squared there, which I haven't put, then what will happen is, a neutron from the top of the Fermi C there's enough kinetic energy, it will decay to a proton and not an electron, a proton and a pi meson. Why not? I have enough, I'm rich, I have enough energy, I can create pi meson. So what will happen is, suddenly neutrons will become unstable for a spontaneous creation of pi mesons. That is trouble, because pi mesons obey Bose-Einstein statistics. Why is it trouble? We'll come to that presently. When do you expect this to happen? Very difficult to calculate because of many body effects and so on, because it's very easy to calculate when the first pi meson will be created. And as more and more pi mesons are created, they will start interacting with one another. So you have to take into account many body interactions of pi mesons, and that's a very subtle and difficult problem. All you can say is roughly twice the nuclear density. What is the nuclear density? 2.5 times 10 to the power 14 grams per cubic centimeter. So what we expect is somewhere around 5 times 10 to the power 14 grams per cubic centimeter, if at all, pi mesons will suddenly appear. Why only pi mesons? There are other kinds of mesons. There are K mesons. K mesons are even more massive. So when the density exceeds about 3 or 4 times the nuclear density, then the neutron can spontaneously create a proton and a K meson. And as I said, the important thing is that both the pi meson, K meson, and all mesons, like photons, obey Bose-Einstein statistics. So now let us discuss, why am I bringing that in? Because what statistics is obeyed by the particle is a matter of life or death for the stars. Because our star has been stable, whether it is a white dwarf or a neutron star, because of the pressure generated by Fermi-Dirac statistics. Now we have to ask, if the statistics is Bose-Einstein statistics, will that make a difference? And it makes a profound difference. Let us first recall, I hope you have all studied this, what is shown below is the Fermi-Dirac distribution function, where the probability that a state of energy K, Ek, is occupied is 1 divided by e to the power Ek minus mu over kT plus 1, where mu is the chemical potential of the Fermi particle. Chemical potential is at absolute zero, is the same as the Fermi energy, but at slightly higher temperature, it is very nearly the same as the Fermi energy. There is a correction which goes as T by Fermi temperature whole squared. So it's extremely small correction. So you are quite safe in assuming that the chemical potential is the Fermi energy. And there is a plus one there. Bose Einstein statistics, on the other hand, is E 1 over exponential to the power Ek minus mu over kT minus 1. So it is that minus 1 is one of the reasons why Bose Einstein statistics leads to very different behavior than Fermi Dirac statistics. And the other reason is the nature of this chemical potential mu. One of the fundamental properties of Bose-Einstein gas is that the chemical potential mu for a Bose-Einstein gas should always be less than zero. It is equal to zero for a photon gas or any other particle whose rest mass is zero. Why is that so? Whereas this restriction is not there for Fermi particles. What is the chemical potential I explained to you before? Chemical potential, roughly speaking, is the energy needed to create one more particle there. Please remember, one more particle and a place for it to sit. The only place for it to sit is on the top of the Fermi sea, because all states below that are already occupied. So that is the chemical potential. Now, if the chemical potential is negative, that means you can spontaneously put as many particles as you want into the system. And that's dangerous. Where does this condition come from? I do not have time in this lecture to digress, but I will indicate for you, you read any book on statistical physics. In statistical mechanics, first thing you do is calculate what is known as some thermodynamic potential. And that to calculate the thermodynamic potential, you will have a term which is summed over all quantum levels k, and what you will have here is exponential to the power, I'm writing this from memory, is E minus mu over kT to the power nk, where nk is the number of particles in state with energy ek. Okay? Now I'm writing that from memory, but I think I've more or less got it right. Now for, and then various derivatives of the thermodynamic potential will give you the free energy, specific heat, susceptibility, and so on. First I have to calculate the free energy. Okay? For a Fermi gas, there's a log, there's a log of this and so on. For a Fermi gas, Nk is either zero or one because of Pauli's principle. In any quantum state K, you can either put zero particle or you can only put one particle. You cannot put two particles. So this infinite series is also summed over Nk. There's another summation. Reduces to only two terms, 1 plus e to the power e minus mu over kT. And then I take the logarithm derivatives, then I get the Fermi Dirac distribution function, 1 over e to the power e minus mu over kT plus 1. But in the case of Bose-Einstein particles, they do not have to obey Pauli's exclusion principle. Therefore, Nk can be 0, 1, 2, 75, million, and so on. And that geometric series will not converge unless each term is less than 1. And since this should be satisfied for all T and all E, convince yourself that's only possible if mu is less than 0. The geometric series will diverge if mu is greater than 0. So that is the origin of why the chemical potential of a Bose-Einstein gas has to be negative. For a photon gas, it is zero. or helium-4 nuclei, it is negative, but not zero. Okay, so this you please read. It will be explained in all statistical mechanics books. So now let's get on and discuss this extremely important phenomena of Bose-Einstein condensation. I don't know how this idea, how Bose's name came into this picture at all, because Bose had no role to play in this. So let's recall very briefly the history. In 1924, Bose was trying to derive Planck's law from fundamental principles by regarding photons as indistinguishable particles. Till then, you remember in classical physics, in Maxwell-Boltzmann statistics, particles are distinguishable. You can name individual molecules and electrons and protons, but according to quantum mechanics, particles are indistinguishable. But nobody had bothered about that difference in statistical physics. Bose was the first person to say, let us assume that photons are indistinguishable particles. And then he derived the statistics and he was able to calculate Planck's distribution, which was rather important. And then he sent the paper to Einstein, and he was a young man in Calcutta, but he had enough confidence in his understanding of physics that he had enough confidence to send a letter to Einstein saying, please read this. If you think this is correct, will you please translate this into German and get it published in a leading German journal? And Einstein read the paper, and he thought that this was an important contribution, deriving Planck's law. And so he forwarded Bose's paper to the German journal, and it was published. Only the name of Bose, S.N. Bose. But as he read Bose's paper, Einstein realized that Bose had not appreciated the really important thing in his discovery, that this applies not just to photon gas. And you should read this marvelous paper by Einstein where he applied it to helium, liquid helium. Now please remember, in 1924, neutron had not been discovered. People didn't know what was inside the helium nucleus, except they knew it had two charges, but he didn't know that there were four particles there and so on. But Einstein instinctively felt that let there be any number of particles there, but there are only two charges there, their spin has to be like this. So the total spin has to be either like this or like this. So the total spin will be not half, but either zero or one. Therefore, helium nuclei also will obey the same statistics, as indeed all integral multiples of H. And then he submitted his own paper, and in that paper, he made this remarkable discovery. To me, it's one of the most brilliant physical insights of Einstein. And to have done that in 1924, I've tried so hard to understand how he could have possibly thought along these lines in 1924, and I've never been able to figure it out. But I'll tell you how we understand it today. So I leave it to you to read Einstein's paper. It's a very readable paper and very beautiful paper. But let me tell it to you in simpler language. Let's first write down the expression for a degenerate Bose gas. The degenerate Bose gas, like the degenerate Fermi gas, has a very different behavior. A degenerate Fermi gas at absolute zero had enormous amount of energy by virtue of Heisenberg's uncertainty principle and Pauli's exclusion principle. Now, but the behavior of a Bose gas at T0 is very different, and the fundamental difference arises because a Bose gas has a negative chemical potential and the fact that they do not have to obey Pauli's exclusion principle. You can put any number of particles in a quantum state. A Fermi gas has a huge zero-point energy, and we supported a white dwarf with that energy. We supported a neutron star with that energy. But a Bose gas, all the particles will be in the state E equal to zero at very low temperatures. Therefore, it can't support anything. Okay. Now, let's try to understand this. Please follow me. It's a very simple argument for why Einstein condensation occurs. As you know, this has finally been experimentally demonstrated a few years ago. The Nobel Prize for Physics was awarded to people who first demonstrated Bose-Einstein condensation in laser-cooled atoms. What is shown there is the expression for the total number of particles in a given volume at a certain temperature T according to Bose-Einstein distribution. This is exactly the same as the expression we wrote for the Fermi gas, integral of the probability that a state of a certain energy is occupied multiplied by the number of energy levels in the interval E and E plus dE integrated over all energy levels. And where did the square root of E dE come from? In terms of momentum, the number of momenta in the between P and P plus dP is 4 pi P squared dP. If I convert P to energy using E is equal to P squared by 2m, then P squared dP becomes square root of E dE. Okay, so that is where that expression comes from. Now please look at this expression very carefully. Inside that bracket with dot, 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 we have the volume also sitting in there, which I have not written. Now this equation in the yellow box determines the chemical potential mu as a function of the other two variables, which is the number of particles and temperature T. You tell me the number of particles, you tell me the temperature, that equation can be, transcendental equation can be solved to calculate the chemical potential. Fine. Now let us decrease the temperature. So please remember, I'm going to decrease the temperature E to the power E minus mu divided by KT minus 1. I am going to decrease the temperature denominator. But the left-hand side is fixed. The number of particles is fixed. Therefore, the right-hand side also must be fixed. Therefore, if I decrease the temperature, the chemical potential must increase because it is negative. So let us write this as the following way. Instead of not getting confused, I write it as plus modulus of mu. Let us say mu, which is negative, is minus modulus of mu. Minus into minus becomes plus. Therefore, as I decrease the temperature, the chemical potential has to decrease. At some temperature T equal to T naught, the chemical potential will become equal to zero. We have to determine by inverting that equation what the temperature is. So have you understood this? Let me repeat. I fix the number of particles and the volume, and I lower the temperature. That equation tells me what the chemical potential should do now. Chemical potential being negative, the modulus of the chemical potential should decrease till finally at a temperature T equal to T naught, the chemical potential becomes equal to zero, like for a photon gas. Let us call the temperature T equal to T naught when mu becomes equal to zero. So I can go back to the first equation that I had written before and do a little change of variables. I can introduce a variable E over exponential to the power E over KT. I can call it a variable Z. And I can take the temperature outside. Then I have an integral 0 to infinity, 1 over e to the power z minus 1, square root of z dz. And you look in any book, that integral is 1.8 times square root of pi. It's a number. Whether you know to integrate or not, it's a number. It has nothing to do with anything. I pulled out temperature outside. Therefore, I get equation for T naught. Is n is proportional to all those factors multiplied by T naught to the power 3 by 2. And that's is what I have shown in this yellow box. So as I lower the temperature, at a temperature T equal to T naught, which is determined by density to the power 2 by 3, chemical potential becomes equal to 0. Fine. Now let us lower the temperature even further. Free country, I'm allowed to lower the temperature further. What will it do? Well, then you say, I have to write this integral. Now I've set mu equal to 0. So this is a slightly different, simpler integral to solve. But then, once again, I can use this trick, exponential to the power u over kt minus 1. I call it as a variable z. Z minus 1, and I can do it. The question is, what is the left-hand side? How should we now interpret the left-hand side? Is the left-hand side is the total number of particles, or is it something else? So far, we had always assumed it's the total number of particles. But it is not the total number of particles anymore. The reason is the following. This is the Bose-Einstein distribution function on the top. The total number of particles is the summation of the Bose-Einstein distribution function over all the quantum states k, and the energy of the state k is E subscript k. It is this summation that we wrote as an integral. In basic statistical mechanics, it's the sum over discrete quantum levels. What we said is, in a very large system, the spacing between these levels is so small that we can treat it as a continuum, and the summation can be replaced by an integral. I don't know if you remember your mathematics, how you replace sum by an integral. You have to put in the number of terms within a certain interval, which is what we call the density of states. But we always forget the first term, which is E equal to 0 term. And we say this is unimportant compared to the other term. So we simply replace sum by an integral. But there is the first term. By converting summation that summation to an integral, we got this integral with which we were dealing with so far. But we have made a serious error, because the number of levels with energy between E and E plus dE is square root of E dE. Therefore, the number of levels around E equal to 0 is 0. In reality, it is not zero. You just allowed it to drop out of the integral. You said, this is unimportant. Come on, don't bother about this. It's a very small correction. But it is not a correction right now. Therefore, the point I'm making is that the density of state, which is square root of E dE, E equal to zero state is left out. But this is precisely the state into which the particles go for T less than zero. That is why I asked the question, how do we interpret the left-hand side as? Do we regard it as a number of particles? No. You say it is a number of particles with energy greater than zero, because I don't know what happened. E equal to zero state has been missed out when I converted the sum to an integral. Okay. So the number of particles with energy E greater than zero is kT to the power 3 by 2, which can be written as T over T0 to the power 3 by 2. I leave it as a very simple exercise by comparing the first equation with the last equation. So I've summarized the important aspect of this equation in the next slide, that the number of particles in energy levels E greater than 0 is n T over T naught to the power 3 by 2. Therefore, the number of particles with energy E equal to 0, the term which got left out, unfortunately, when you converted the sum to an integral, is 1 minus this, or n minus this, right? Yeah. So that is, the number of particles at the energy level E equal to 0 is n into 1 minus T by T0 to the power 3 by 2. Therefore, at T equal to 0, all the particles will be in the E equal to 0 state, like in a Boltzmann gas. And this is not forbidden, because Bose-Einstein particles do not have to obey Pauli's exclusion principle. Please remember, this is a condensation not in real space. This is a condensation of molecules in real space. Instead of occupying the whole room, these molecules have said, no, I'll be inside this bottle. But this is a condensation in momentum space or in energy space. Okay, so the Bose-Einstein condensation is very different. So here is an experimental demonstration, the kind of demonstration for which the Nobel Prize was given. What is shown here are the velocity distribution of a collection of alkali atoms as they are cooled using multiple laser beams, 200 nanokelvin, 100 nanokelvin, very close to the absolute zero temperature. You see most of those particles are now in the zero velocity, zero momentum, and zero energy state. Now it should be stressed that so far we have considered an ideal Bose gas, meaning interaction between bosons has not been taken into account. Okay. Now, as I said in the earlier lecture, in 1938, Fritz London proposed that the phenomena of superfluidity in helium-4 and superconductivity in metals is related to this phenomena of Bose-Einstein condensation. Later on, people said, no, this is nonsense, because scattering experiments with neutrons showed that only about 10% of the atoms in superfluid helium are actually in the condensate. But we now know that, we now know from this experiments with these alkali atoms that when they become superfluid, everything is in the condensate. Okay, so Fritz London was right after all. So let's get back to the neutron star. We created pi mesons at 2 or 3 times the nuclear density because instead of electrons, neutrons decay to protons and pi mesons. And these pi mesons obey Bose-Einstein statistics, and at low temperature, the pi mesons will condense into the zero momentum state. The number of particles in the zero momentum state is given by this expression we wrote down before. 1 minus T by T naught to the power 3 by 2, where T naught or TC is given by density to the power 2 by 3, just like in Fermi energy, Fermi temperature. At T equal to 0, all the pi mesons will be in the zero momentum state, and this is the phenomenon of Bose-Einstein condensation. The important thing is these pi mesons will not supply any pressure. Just as Boyle's law of pressure goes to zero at T equal to zero because all motion stopped in classical physics, here all energies go to zero as you approach T equal to zero, at T less than T naught. It's a matter of life or death for the star whether pi mesons are spontaneously created or not. As long as neutrons remained as neutrons, they will supply pressure. But if 50% of the neutrons decide to become pi mesons, God knows what will happen. Okay? And people have suggested that those neutron stars will become black holes. So the conjecture is, we talked of a solid crust of about a kilometer. Inside that, there is just a fluid of neutrons, protons, and electrons in beta equilibrium. There is phenomena of superfluidity and superconductivity. Now we are saying there is a possibility that below that there could be pi mesons and k mesons. We don't know. How do we know whether they exist or not? Well, from observational inferences. For example, the theory says that if pi mesons and k mesons do occur, then because of the various decay processes in which they emit neutrinos, that neutron star will cool much faster than a neutron star without pi mesons and k mesons. Why is that important? Because the Chandra Observatory detects the black body X-rays from hot neutron stars. And if you can detect black body X-rays from a neutron star which is a million years old, that means that neutron star has not cooled, its temperature is still 10 million degrees. Therefore, you can infer that you say what you like, but I don't think there are any pi mesons or came as ons inside the nucleus. This is the kind of argument. I'm not saying the issues are settled, but there are issues that can be settled by observation. Now, let's talk a little bit about even higher densities, if they arise at all. Now, we know that neutrons and protons are not fundamental particles, that they are in fact made of quarks and antiquarks. And it has been suggested that when you reach a temperature of 10 to the power 12 Kelvin, or the corresponding density, then the neutrons will melt into quarks and antiquarks, protons will melt, and that you will have a soup of quarks bound together by gluons. We will return to this in the very last lecture when we discuss the very early universe, because which is the only other circumstance when you can talk about such very high temperatures. Now, people have also said, very learned people, have said that if quarks form spontaneously, all the neutrons will convert into quarks. So it'll become a quark star. Now, I don't believe it for the following reasons. There are some very specific reasons. Such quark stars will have even higher neutrino luminosity. So observatories like the Chandra Observatory will be able to put bounds on how rapidly neutron stars cool. Therefore, in the future, you can say, no, this cannot happen. There is also another very important thing. These quark stars are not expected to have a solid crust. Now, if you don't have a solid crust, you can't have pulsars. So the very fact that neutron stars work as pulsars tells us that they have solid crust, which tells us that, therefore, maybe this quark gluon star is probably just a theoretical conjecture. These are not issues that are settled yet, but I merely want to say that don't be swayed just because these ideas emanate from very eminent people. Because, as my teacher taught me, physics is an experimental science. So, the ultimate arbiter of the experiments, right? So, we'll wait. So, I put a big question mark there. So, to summarize, what is shown here, in the y-axis is the density in grams per cubic centimeter. In the x-axis is the radius of the star. And the various curves correspond to various modern sophisticated equations of state. People have included pi mesons, k mesons, quarks, two-body forces, three-body forces, four-body forces, various kinds of sophistication. You notice they seem to fall into three categories. There are curves which more or less hug one another, and there are curves to the left, and there are curves to the right. The curve to the right is a very stiff equation of state. The curve to the left is a very soft equation of state, which will give rise to very high densities at which you expect to see pi, k mesons, quarks, and things like that. Now, most people believe in these central equations of state. The important thing to appreciate is that most of these equations of state predict neutron stars of about 10 or 11 kilometers, and their central density is about 10 to the 15 grams per cubic centimeter, as Oppenheimer and Volkov calculated 80 years ago. So regardless of which is your favorite equation of state, you can take that. Now let's look at this slightly differently. What is plotted on the y-axis is the gravitational mass. Please remember, in the case of white dwarfs, the mass of the white dwarf is the mass of all the elementary particles. But in a neutron star, we have to take into account general relativity. So mass is not just the sum of rest masses, but binding energy divided by c squared. So what is plotted on the y-axis is the gravitational mass as a function of central density. You see that all these equations of state predict maximum mass. For example, here is an equation of state with mesons. So the maximum mass it predicts is very different. It's only 1.4 solar mass or so. But these favorite equations of state predict a maximum mass around 2 solar mass. And most of them predict a radius of about 10 kilometers. So to summarize 80 years after Oppenheimer and Volkov, 81 years after Oppenheimer and Volkov, if you blindly applied Chandrasekhar's theory, you would say the maximum mass of a neutron star will be at a density where it becomes completely relativistic, about 5.76 solar mass. If you say, no, I have to take into account general relativity, then you would say Oppenheimer and Volkov, the maximum mass is about 0.7 solar mass. But modern values of maximum mass is about 2 solar mass, as conjectured by Oppenheimer already in 1938 in the absence of any nuclear physics. Okay? So he wasn't wrong after all. What are the measured masses? Roughly 1.4 solar mass, a few of them a little more massive. So let's conclude on the following note to set up a discussion for discussion of black holes. This is what Chandrasekhar would have drawn had he chosen to draw this picture in 1932. But he could have said it only in 1938. So there are white dwarfs, and then there are neutron stars. There is a maximum mass for a neutron star. The question is, what happens to stars more massive than that? And he said in 32 that for all stars of mass greater than a critical mass, the perfect gas equation of state does not break down, however high the density may become, and the matter does not become degenerate. An appeal to Fermi-Dirac statistics to avoid the central singularity cannot be made. And so he would have said that these stars collapse to a singularity. Now, in 1938, Oppenheimer asked another student, say, let's do this problem properly within the framework of general relativity and ask what happens to massive stars. Is Chandrasekhar right that they will become singularities? So this is a harder problem than Volkov's problem. So you needed a person who was very good in mathematics and very careful with mathematics. So he found such a student. His name was Hartland Snyder. This student was a truck driver. He used to drive big American trucks. So one day he decided, look, I'm bored of truck driving. I want to become a physicist. It's a true story. So he asked somebody, do you know any clever physicists I can go and study with? He said, yeah, there is a guy in Berkeley, California, named Robert Oppenheimer. You go and work with him. So he went there, and Oppenheimer was very impressed with this kid. He was very different from the other students because they took after Oppenheimer. They were all experts in music, good food, and literature, and art, and things like that. This guy came from a truck-driving background. But he was very good in mathematics, and more importantly, very careful in mathematics. So Oppenheimer told Snyder, look, here is a nice problem for you. Take a massive star and study its collapse under general relativistic conditions. I'm going to allow you to make some approximation because it's an extremely difficult problem. You assume the star to be spherical. Don't bother about rotation of the star. Don't worry about too much about what's happening inside, energy generation, pressure, all sorts of things. Take a simple spherical rotating, non-rotating star, but don't make any approximation whatsoever to general relativity. A hypothetical star, but study it rigorously within the framework of general relativity. And within a year, this young Snyder had solved the problem. And they wrote the famous paper, Oppenheimer and Snyder, in 1939. And to me, this paper is as important in the overthrow of the Aristotelian dictum as Chandrasekhar's paper of 1930 and 31. What Snyder found was that as the star nears the critical radius, which we will call the Schwarzschild radius, 2gm by c squared, its shrinkage slows down. Till it becomes frozen precisely at the critical radius, a very strange behavior. If I drop a stone from the top of a mountain, it will accelerate faster and faster to higher and higher velocity. Here, you would expect a collapsing star to collapse faster and faster. But he found that the collapse slows down till finally it stops collapsing. But he found another very remarkable thing. As far as a distant observer is concerned, he found that the collapse becomes faster and faster, doesn't stop at all. So you have diametrically opposite description depending on whether you believe an astronomer on the star or whether you believe an astronomer at infinity looking at the star. Very strange behavior. And the last sentence of this paper, when all thermonuclear sources of energy are exhausted, a sufficiently massive star will collapse. The radius of the star approaches asymptotically its gravitational radius. Light from the surface of the star is progressively reddened and can escape over a progressively narrower and narrower angles. The star thus tends to close itself off from any communication with a distant observer. Only its gravitational field persists. In other words, they'll become black holes. What is inside the black hole? What is the fate of the collapsing star? Schneider found that the star continued to collapse till it became a space-time singularity, as Chandrasekhar had said in 1932. But they didn't talk about it. Obviously, they didn't like it. So although the result was there in black and white, it was not explicitly spelled out. Perhaps Oppenheimer philosophically didn't like the idea of a star becoming a singularity. And what was the other reaction? We already encountered Eddington's reaction much earlier in 1935. The star has to go on radiating and radiating and contracting until, I suppose, it gets down to a few kilometers in radius when gravity becomes strong enough to hold in the radiation and the star can at last find peace. Various accidents may intervene to save the star, but I want more protection than that. I think there should be a law of nature to prevent a star from behaving in this absurd way. Around the same time as Oppenheimer and Schneider's paper in 1939, Einstein published a paper, a mathematically rigorous paper, in which he concluded an essential result of this investigation is a clear understanding as to why the Schwarzschild singularities do not exist in physical reality. Sadly, although this paper was mathematically rigorous, he got the physics wrong. So he rejected black holes. The day Oppenheimer and Schneider's paper appeared in Physical Review, World War II was declared. Physics came to a halt for 6 years. Physicists joined in the war effort. And as for Oppenheimer, he led the team in Los Alamos, which built the first atom bomb. Black holes were forgotten. They were revived in the year 1964, soon after quasars were discovered. We'll come to the story in the second last lecture. Before questions, in the next lecture, we will come closer to where I want to head in these lectures. Remember, I started by saying we want to be able to understand how two neutron stars merged and produced gravitational waves. So the first step in the understanding is, how are neutron stars formed in a binary system? So it's a very beautiful story, and we will discuss that next time. Are there questions in today's lecture? Yes?
Sir, I didn't understand that how the when the density increases, it becomes more and more ideal, the gas. Like that ratio, kinetic energy and potential energy. What happens?
The kinetic energy of a Fermi gas is of the order of the Fermi energy is of the order of density to the power 2 by 3. The potential energy, the Coulomb energy, is of the order of 1 over mean particle distance, is of the order of density to the power 1 by 3. Therefore, the ratio of kinetic energy to potential energy is proportional to density to the power 1 by 3. Therefore, as density increases, kinetic energy becomes more important. So the gas becomes more ideal, which means you are neglecting the potential energy can be more and more rigorously justified. This is only true for a Coulomb potential energy. If I replace 1 over r by 1 over r to the power 6 or r to the power 12, van der Waals equation of state or whatever it is, that's no longer true. So that is not true for neutrons and protons and so on. Is that clear now? Okay. Yeah. Can you just? Oh, you had a question, eh? Okay, fine.
That why is there a repulsion of neutrons in small spaces?
Sorry?
Repulsion among neutrons.
That is the law of nature. Okay, to explain that, why is there a repulsion of neutrons? At this level, you can only say it's a law of nature because experimentally you find it. But ultimately you have to explain it, right? So that is what all this quantum chromodynamics is all about. Where you say, what is quantum chromodynamics? It is a theory of strong interactions. According to strong interactions, what is inside a neutron and proton or quarks, various colors, charm, up, down, etc., etc., and the forces between the quarks are mediated by these gluons. If that is the theory of elementary particles, which is the theory of strong interaction that people have been pursuing for the past, since 1960s, then that theory should predict what should be the behavior at various distances. Okay, so that theory would tell you that theory tells you that at very short distances, that attraction will become repulsive and later on attractive. It also tells you that at very, very short distances, there is no interaction at all. No, not long distance. That is very short distance, high density, right? In other words, you can't separate quarks. It costs you energy to separate quarks. So as quarks become closer and closer together, they become more and more free. They become more and more ideal. There is hardly any interaction between them. That is as important. Right? I'm saying answer to your question is that theory should answer your question. The detail, the objective of the theory is to explain the internuclear potential. You call it what you like. You call it quark, bundle of quarks, or I call it neutrons, he calls it proton. Ultimately, you have to explain what is the behavior of the potential energy curve as a function of density, right? Yeah. Oh, you already have it. Okay.
The Oppenheimer, Volkov, the line that they gave on the graph, he completely dismissed the right-hand side after the peak. But that the whole graph was given by their equation of state, right? So it must have accounted for the...
No. Equation doesn't tell you whether it is a stable solution. The differential equation gives you solution. You then have to test the stability of the solution. So when you do that, they use the turning point method. In other words, you have to ask, is the solution stable or not? Beyond the maximum, solution is not stable. If you read standard books, Shapiro and Tucholsky, and on I think it's called White Dwarf, Neutron Stars and Black Holes, or any book on relativistic astrophysics, that will be explained why that branch is unstable. You are right, a differential equation gives you a solution, but then you have to test the stability of this. Yes? Either pass it around or just speak up. I can repeat your question.
You said that the degenerate Bose gas doesn't follow the exclusion principle, right? Mm-hmm. But why does it not follow that?
I don't know whether anybody knows the answer to that. You see, so let me try to give as honest an answer as one possibly can. The elementary particles have intrinsic angular momentum. We don't know where this angular momentum came from. In the very beginning, people even entertained the idea maybe the electron is actually spinning like a top. And there was the two people who discovered it, Uhlenbeck and Goudsmit, they came to a railway station where Professor Ehrenfest was catching a train to Leiden in Holland, trying to convince him. And Pauli was very upset. He came running as the train started moving and he said, spin is a humbug, spin is a humbug, meaning it's a lie. Later on, nobody got more mileage out of spin than Pauli himself, okay? Because at that time, it was very easy to demonstrate that if spin was really related to the rotation of the electron, then the surface of the electron must be moving at a speed greater than the speed of light to produce that much of angular momentum. Then that notion was abandoned, and a safer notion that it's an intrinsic angular momentum. Where did it come from? I don't know. Nobody in the world knows why electron has a charge, why it has a mass. It's a property. So it has an intrinsic angular momentum. Fine, let's leave it. Second thing is, this intrinsic angular momentum can be either integral or non-integral multiple of h power by 2. Right? If it is a non-integral multiple, half, 3/2, 5/2, 7/2 times the Planck's constant, then you say it obeys Fermi-Dirac statistics. If it is an integral multiple, 0, 1, 2, h bar, then you say it obeys Bose-Einstein statistics. Why this is so, there is no obvious answer. There was a paper by Pauli and one of his students, Fiertz, in the 1930s, where they proved a theorem. It's a very involved thing, deep in relativistic quantum field theory. They found a connection between spin and statistics. It is called spin statistics theorem. Now, Feynman, as you know, always believes that if you really understood something, it doesn't matter how complicated your theory is, you ought to be able to state it in simple terms to a school kid. Can we tell why there is a connection between spin and statistics? We can't. So Feynman says in his book, Lectures in Physics, he says, look, someday we will have a simple explanation, but right now, treat it as a law of nature, which we still don't understand. Now let's go back to the second question about Bose-Einstein's principle. Pauli's principle. Where did this thing come from? Let us consider two electrons and let us interchange their position, exchange. Then the question is, what will be the property of the wave function before and after the exchange of particle? Then Pauli showed that for electrons and particles with half integral spin, that wave function must be anti-symmetric with respect to the exchange of particles. So there should be a minus sign. And that is the origin of Pauli's exclusion principle, the anti-symmetry of wave functions under exchange. Now for Bose particles, that wave function is symmetric. Therefore, it doesn't have to obey Pauli's exclusion principle. So that is the only level at which I have ever understood this. So whether or not a particle obeys Pauli's principle or not is related to its symmetry properties under exchange direction. Any other question? Yes, you had a question there.
So this is with respect to the last lecture. So you mentioned, summarized in a way that gravitational potential produces acceleration and curvilinear coordinates produce acceleration. So I got a little confused about the terminology you used. It produces acceleration.
if there is a rotating platform in the middle of the room, you will not feel any acceleration. But the moment you come to the center of the room and step on it, suddenly you feel a centrifugal acceleration. Because you are now in a rotating frame. So I can say rotation produces acceleration. It's not because there is a force in that platform which is absent outside the platform. That acceleration is simply by virtue of rotation. So it is, if you now write the rotating coordinate system, then that will not be a Cartesian coordinate system. In other words, ds squared will not be sum of the squares of individual dx squared, dy squared. There'll be cross terms, okay? So it is in that sense I use the word that acceleration can be due to, by virtue of the coordinate system in which you happen to be. It's not a real acceleration, it's a fictitious force, because the moment I go to a different frame, I don't have that acceleration. Same thing with Coriolis force. Okay? You still are not convinced?
No, I'm convinced with the, the idea is not very intuitive to understand that there's a fictitious force which is a cause.
When you talk of Coriolis force, we use the word Coriolis force, right? But we shouldn't have ever used the word Coriolis force. We should have really said Coriolis acceleration. Isn't it? There is a difference between force and acceleration. There is this minor matter of a mass coming in. Don't bring it in. Don't bring it in. Because the moment you bring in mass, then you begin equality of inertial and gravitational mass, and then you bring gravity into it and all that, nothing. So this was Einstein's point. Newton said gravity is due to a force, and that force causes acceleration according to my second law, F is equal to ma. Einstein said, no, I don't agree with that. Newton was right in saying gravity produces acceleration, full stop. Don't say anything more. Explain this acceleration, that's all. Why bring in the notion of a force? Explain this acceleration. And then his explanation was that space-time is curved, and therefore geodesic motion is not straight line. It's a curved path, and in a curved path, there is acceleration. And you call that acceleration gravity. Call it x, y, z. People called it historically gravity. So he said gravitational acceleration is metrical in origin, because geodesic motion. Any other acceleration is also metrical in origin. It is due to coordinate system. So he said there is no difference between gravitational acceleration and acceleration produced by fictitious forces like centrifugal force, Coriolis force, and all that. In that sense, they're all metrical in origin. Okay, so that is the really beautiful idea. And therefore, because it's not connected with force, F is equal to ma need not be brought in at all. So acceleration has nothing to do with mass. If you moment you relate acceleration to mass by bringing in F equal to ma, the same force can result in different acceleration for different masses. But that's not what Galileo found. But there was no explanation for it by anybody for 500 years. The only explanation till today is it is because gravitational acceleration is not due to gravitational force. It is due to curvature of space-time. Okay. You know, there are two ways of looking at it. Very fancy language. But why the hell did we ever think space-time should be Cartesian, Euclidean? That's only because that's the only geometry we knew till Gauss came along. Okay, so there are two ways of looking at it. The most natural thing to assume, this is what Einstein thinking was, the most natural thing to assume that this is curved. Under certain circumstances, that curvature is zero. It could be positive, negative. Then to assume that it must be flat is such an artificial assumption, which I personally think is because that's the only geometry that had been ever formulated till Gauss formulated a two-dimensional curve geometry, and then Riemann generalized it. But then physicists were not aware of all that. Right? Even Einstein was not aware of it. But some physicists were aware. For example, in 1909, Einstein was present in a talk given by Max Born, sitting in the front row like she is doing. And Max Born was talking about rigid bodies in special relativity. And he was talking about deformable bodies in special relativity. And he said deformable bodies should be described in terms of Riemannian geometry. He introduced the notion of Riemann-Christoffel tensor, the Ricci tensor, everything that Marcel Grossman taught Einstein. But it all went over Einstein's head. That's why his teacher Minkowski called him a sleepy dog. He wasn't paying any attention. So the notion that you use Riemannian geometry had already been introduced into physics by Max Born in the context of special relativity in discussing deformable bodies in special relativity. Okay. So, I hope. You have to think some more, you know. Don't think that. Understanding an insight is like quickly pointing a camera and something coming into focus. It has to come into focus and then it goes out of focus, then again it comes into focus, again become out of focus. That, to me at least, that is the process of learning. And eventually you say, okay, I think I understand it. And then you try to explain it to your friend, and then all the understanding evaporates. The confusion again comes. But that is the process of insight. We think of Einstein, I said all that in such elegant, condensed form. But that was 10 years of monumental confusion by a person of intellect of Albert Einstein. It didn't come to him overnight. Right? I mean, it's years and years of struggle. So don't give up. Anything else? We haven't come to that yet. Are we beyond the maximum mass? That's what Oppenheimer and Snyder showed. Yes. They will collapse to singularities. After that, there is no stable equilibrium. There is no object like a black hole. Don't you understand? We will discuss that. There are regions of space from which light does not come. You call them black holes. But if you actually go there is nothing there. Whatever went through that has gone, become a singularity. Okay, so there are no physical objects like black holes. There are only gravitational influences due to some hypothetical objects of that mass and that radius which we call as black holes. Black hole is a perfectly harmless, innocent body. Simply because something doesn't emit light, why is it harmful? Nothing. If I turn off the light, I can't see you. People got excited about black holes. Einstein rejected it violently. Eddington rejected it violently. The whole world rejected it violently because Schwarzschild showed that once it becomes a black hole, it will become a singularity. That is unacceptable to us because we don't know how to describe a singularity. You understand? So black hole, nobody is bothered by black hole. It is the second statement. Okay, that's why Chandrasekhar was so violently attacked by Eddington, because Eddington was the first person, according to what little I have read, who very clearly saw that the moment his book on mathematical theory of relativity, it's very clear to him that the moment it comes to that radius, it will have no option but to collapse to a singularity. And that is what people found philosophically hard to cope with. Okay. And then people like Roger Penrose came and said, that has to happen, and showed it in such a rigorous fashion mathematically, there's simply no way to escape. And that's like rubbing salt in the wound. People got even more upset about it. And that's where it stands now. I mean, we still don't know how to deal with singularity. Good, yes. Then we'll stop with this. Because his name was David Hilbert. Come inside. See, first of all, what happened is that Einstein, earlier that year, Einstein went to Göttingen and gave some lectures where he talked about his idea of this Riemannian manifold and constructing a law of gravity and his struggle with finding the correct differential equations. So, and Hilbert attended those seminars by Einstein. So that is when he got tuned into this problem. And then he looked at it mathematically. Okay, he went on vacation somewhere and then took a pad and pencil and wrote. The honest answer to your question, that is why I insist, there is no derivation of Einstein's field equations any more than there is a derivation of Maxwell's equation. Although I'm told that Feynman had scribbled something which he thought was a way to derive Maxwell's equation. And Freeman Dyson found that and then published it. I myself would like to read what Freeman Dyson wrote. So there is no Maxwell. Maxwell had all kinds. I have seen those models. In fact, when I went to work in the Cavendish Laboratory shifted from the old premise, from Maxwell, Rayleigh, Rutherford days to the new building. And in the corridor of the, one of the wings, in all of Maxwell's equipment is kept in the corridor as exhibit. There you'll see wooden wheels and with teeth in them, this rotating that. So he was playing around with this idea of divergence and curl using mechanical model. And then he wrote down these differential equations, right? So in the same way, you're asking a valid question. Why did Hilbert choose that action, that Lagrangian? Can't say. He did that and he got the same result that Einstein got. So in that sense, there is no. So that is why Chandrasekhar taught us one possible way to understand how Einstein wrote that is to follow the argument that I gave systematically, how each equation of Newton, U equal to zero, del squared U equal to zero, Poisson's equation, how they should be generalized to a Riemannian manifold, is the way he arrived at the equation, not by starting with the Lagrangian. So I Landau and Lipschitz, for example, will do it the way Hilbert did it. You start with that. Yeah, right. So why you chose that Lagrangian, it's a valid question. I don't know. Should ask some people working in this institute. They understand these things better. Yes. Any other question? Yes, that's look in Landau and Lipschitz's classical theory of fields. Special theory of relativity tells you how to calculate the energy momentum tension. Yeah, special theory of relativity tells you how to calculate energy momentum tension. Or if you're dealing with a collection of particles, or if you're dealing with electromagnetic field, or some other fields, and so on, there's clear prescription of how to calculate the energy momentum. Okay. Yes. Good. So we will continue with binary systems next time. And after that, I will have two lectures on which are related to recycle pulsars and millisecond pulsars. These are important in the context of gravitational wave detection. Okay, fine.